Chapter 6. The Plan. The next morning I was awakened by the sound of loud voices. "Flag of truce!" I heard someone yell. Then, "It's silver!" I got up and rubbed my eyes. Sure enough, two men stood just outside the stockade. One of them was waving a white cloth, and the other was Silver himself. "Stay inside," said the captain. 10-1 says this is a trick." Then he shouted to the buccaneers, "Who goes there? Stand or we'll fire." "Flag of truce," cried Silver. "What do you want with your flag of truce?" Captain Smollett shouted back. "Captain Silver wishes to make terms," the other man called out. "Captain Silver," said the captain. "Don't know him. Who's he?" John Silver answered, "Me, sir. These poor lads have chosen me captain after your desertion, sir. We're willing to submit if we can come to terms and no bones about it." Captain Smollett agreed to meet with Silver, and only Silver. Silver threw his crutch over the fence, got a leg up, and with great vigor and skill, climbed over the fence and dropped to the other side. "Well, now," he said, "that was a good scare you gave us last night. We lost some men, but you mark me, Cap'n, it won't work twice," said Silver. "We want that treasure, and we'll have it. You would just as soon save your lives, I reckon. We want the map, so if you hand it over, we won't do you no harm." "Not a chance," replied the captain. "Give us the map," said Silver, "and stop shooting poor seamen. If you do that, we'll give you a choice. You can come aboard with us once the treasure is stowed away, and I'll give you my word of honor to put you ashore somewhere safe. Or if that ain't to your fancy, you can stay here. We'll divide the supplies with you, and I'll send the first ship I sight to pick you up." "Is that all?" Captain Smollett asked. "Now hear me. If you come up one by one unarmed, I'll clap you all in irons and take you home to a fair trial in England. If not, it won't end well for you." Silver looked scornfully at the captain. "Give me a hand up," he cried. "Not I," returned Captain Smollett. "Who'll give me a hand up?" Silver roared. Not one among us moved. Silver had to crawl along the sand, grumbling till he got close to the door and could hoist himself up on his crutch. Then he spat into the spring. "Before an hour's out, I'll knock in your old log house. Them that die will be the lucky ones," he cried. As soon as Silver left the stockade, we returned to our posts and loaded our muskets. There were several small holes in the walls of the log house. We peered out through the holes and waited for the onslaught. "Put out the fire," shouted the captain. "We mustn't have smoke in our eyes." Suddenly, with a loud cry, a group of pirates leaped from the woods on the north side and ran straight toward the stockade. At the same time, gunfire opened from the woods. A rifle ball sang through the doorway and knocked the doctor's musket to bits. The pirates climbed over the fence like monkeys. We fired at them, and immediately three of them fell to the ground. Four others made it over the fence and charged forward. In an instant, they were upon us. "Adam, all hands," one of the pirates roared in a voice of thunder. One pirate grasped Hunter's musket and wrenched it out of his hands. With one stunning blow, he laid poor Hunter senseless on the floor. Meanwhile, another pirate appeared in the doorway and descended upon the doctor with his cutlass. The log house was filled with smoke, cries, and confusion. Flashes and the reports of pistol shots rang out. "Out, lads, and fight 'em in the open," cried Captain Smollett. Silver looked scornfully at the captain. "Give me a hand up," he cried. I snatched a cutlass and dashed out into the sunlight. "Round the house, lads, round the house," the captain cried. I raised my cutlass and ran round the corner of the house. The next moment, I found myself face to face with a pirate named Job Anderson. He roared and raised his cutlass. I leaped to one side and rolled headlong down the slope. Gray followed close behind me and took down Anderson before he had time to recover. Another pirate was shot while firing into the house. The doctor had taken down a third. Of the pirates who had made it over the fence, only one remained, and he had seen enough. He dropped his cutlass and clambered back over the fence. In 3 seconds, nothing remained of the attacking party but the ones who had fallen. I ran full speed back to the house. Somewhat cleared of smoke, I assessed the price we had paid for the victory. Hunter lay on the ground, stunned. Joyce had been killed. In the center, the squire was holding up the captain, one as pale as the other. "The captain's wounded," said Mr. Trelawney. "Have they run?" asked Captain Smollett. "All that could," returned the doctor. "But there are some that will never run again." "That's good," cried the captain. "That means fewer men. That's better odds than when we started." The mutineers did not return. They had had enough, so we were able to tend to our wounded and get some food. After dinner, the doctor grabbed his hat, pistols, and a cutlass. He slipped the map in his pocket and, with a musket over his shoulder, climbed the fence, setting off briskly through the trees. "Is he mad?" Gray asked me. "I would not have thought him capable of such a thing," I said. "I bet he's going to see Ben Gunn." I was right, as I found out later. In the meantime, I had another thought. The house was stifling. I began to envy the doctor walking in the cool shadows of the woods. I longed to escape and set about gathering supplies for my own excursion. I filled both coat pockets with biscuits, then took 2 pistols to arm myself. As for the scheme I had in my head, it was not a bad one in itself. I would go down to the shore and look for Ben Gunn's boat. I knew it was wrong to slip out when nobody was watching, but I was only a boy, and I was determined. While the squire and Gray were busy helping the captain with his bandages, I bolted into the woods. Before my absence was noticed, I was out of earshot of my companions. This was my second foolish decision, and it was far worse than the first, for there were only 2 honest men left to guard the log house. Much like the first time, though, I did it for the good of us all. I headed up the east coast of the island. After a while, I came out into the open and saw the sea lying blue and sunny to the horizon and the surf tumbling its foam along the beach. In the distance, I could see the Hispaniola, the Jolly Roger, waving in the breeze. The sun was setting, and it grew dark in earnest. I knew I must lose no time if I were to find Ben Gunn's boat that evening. The white rock was still further down the sandy spit, and it took me a while to get to it. Below the rock was a little hollow, and tucked away inside, covered in old sackcloth, was Ben Gunn's boat. It was a homemade coracle, a lopsided frame of wood lined with goatskin. It was extremely small, even for me, but it was light and portable. I thought the mutineers might be planning to raise anchor and sail away. I wondered how I might be able to prevent this. I could paddle out in Ben Gunn's boat under cover of night, cut the ship loose, and let her drift toward the shore. I waited for darkness to fall. As the last rays of daylight disappeared, absolute darkness settled over Treasure Island, and I shoved Ben Gunn's boat out of the hollow. The little coracle was a safe boat for someone my size, but she was the most difficult craft to manage. Turning round and round was the maneuver at which she was best. She turned in every direction but the one I chose. However, by good fortune, the tide swept me down to where the Hispaniola was anchored. As I drew near, I could hear loud voices in the cabin. One I recognized as Israel Hands, who was having a disagreement with another pirate. Both men were angry, and oaths flew like hailstones. I quietly rowed next to the schooner, then carefully cut the ropes that held the ship in place. The Hispaniola drifted free in the current. To my surprise, the coracle suddenly lurched. She seemed to change course, and her speed had strangely increased. I realized that I was being whirled along by the wake of the Hispaniola. The current turned at right angles, sweeping the tall schooner and the little coracle out to sea. Not knowing what to do, I lay on the bottom of my boat, sure this would be my final day. I must have lain there motionless for some time, but then, even in the midst of my fear, weariness overcame me and I fell asleep. When I awoke, it was broad daylight. I found myself tossing about in the boat at the southwestern end of Treasure Island. I was barely a quarter of a mile from the shore, and my first thought was to paddle in. I soon saw the problem with this idea. The coast was rocky, and powerful waves crashed against the rocks. If I tried to land, I might be dashed to death upon the rough shore. I attempted to paddle to a safer landing spot along the cape, but there was no use. Try as I might, the current carried the coracle past the point of the cape. There I beheld a sight that changed the nature of my thoughts. It was the Hispaniola. I knew that there were at least a few pirates on board, but I could not see any of them. To and fro, up and down, the ship sailed by swoops and dashes, as if nobody was steering. I thought maybe the pirates had deserted the ship, or maybe they were sleeping. I figured if I could get on board, I could return the ship to the captain. I set myself to paddle, and did so till I drew up alongside the ship, and the bowsprit was just over my head. I sprang to my feet and leaped up, pushing the coracle underwater. Then, with one hand, I caught the jibboom and pulled myself up onto the deck of the Hispaniola. At first, I did not see a soul. However, on the after deck, I discovered the two men who had been left to watch the ship. One was on his back, lifeless. A little further on sat Israel Hands, propped up against the ship wall with his chin on his chest. His hands lay open, and his face was as white as a candle. I saw the signs of a fight and felt sure the two men had killed each other. Just then, Israel Hands gave a low moan. He opened his eyes wearily and caught sight of me. He said only two words, "Help me!"